Hello friends, good morning. I'm Srishti and I'm back with another set of 5 questions of finance for you. Today we are going to discuss the current affairs finance questions as well as the financial management related questions. Do pay the attention till the end of the video so that you could have some basic knowledge about some key concepts of finance. If you haven't subscribed to our channel yet, then do subscribe to our channel for more beneficial videos. You will get regularly updates if you would subscribe to our channel. So starting with the first question of today. So before starting with this question, let me tell you that a case study format of question is less likely to come in your examinations. They may ask you directly the prudential norms and its implications, but I have chosen the case study format because I thought that it would be interesting for you and it will help you better understand the concept. So as you can see, this question relates to P2P lending firms. So let's start the question. Rupee Circle, a P2P lending firm, is lending 45,000 to Mr. A for a period of 3.5 years. Aggregate amount that Rupee Circle is lending as on August 31st, 2019 is 10,20,000 rupees. Also, while calculating the financial ratios, it found that its leverage ratio is below 2. How many norms are violated by Rupee Circle, if any? To answer this question, you must know that what are the prudential norms set by RBI for these P2P lending firms. Because a direct question related to those norms can be asked in your examination. So let's look at the norms one by one in the next slide. Okay, so before discussing these prudential norms, let me first tell you that what is P2P lending. So P2P lending platforms connect borrowers with individual lenders who come together to meet the borrower's loan requirements. So it is basically a platform which connects the borrowers and the lenders. So such borrowings from P2P platforms are unsecured loans. And obviously, then the interest rates charged by these lenders will be higher as compared to the banks and NBFCs. So some of the P2P firms are Faircent, Lender Club, Finzi, Rupee Circle, as it was mentioned in the question also. Okay, so let's see the norms one by one. Now you must be wondering that why this NBFC P2P is there. So these P2P lending firms are regulated by RBI because of the high growth in lending in these platforms and they receive the NBFC status also. So these NBFC P2P shall maintain a leverage ratio not exceeding 2. The next one is that the aggregate exposure of a lender to all the borrowers at any point of time. Notice here that at any point of time across all the P2Ps that should not exceed 10 lakh rupees. So a particular lender cannot lend more than 10 lakh rupees and that is why these P2P lending firms has also written a letter to RBI stating that this 10 lakh rupee norm is posing a great risk to their existence. The third one is that the aggregate loans taken by a borrower. Now this norm is from the perspective of the borrower. So the aggregate loans taken by a borrower at any point of time across all P2P shall be subject to a cap of 10 lakh rupees. So the aggregate exposure for the lender is also 10 lakh and the aggregate loans taken by a borrower at any point of time that is also limited at 10 lakh. The next one is that exposure of a single lender to the same borrower across all P2P shall not exceed 50,000 rupees. So a single lender, suppose Rupee Circle in our question, he cannot give more than rupees 50,000 to Mr. A, one borrower across all the P2Ps. Then the next one is that the maturity of the loans shall not exceed 36 months or we can say 3 years. Now after understanding these prudential norms which have been given by RBI, let's move back to the question to see that what norms have been violated by Rupee Circle, if any. Okay, so looking at the figures now, P2P lending firm has lent 45,000 to Mr. A. So this one is correct because it is below 50,000 rupees. As we have read that a single lender to the same borrower across all P2Ps, it should not lend beyond 50,000. But this lending of 45,000 loan, it has a maturity of 3.5 years. So this is the first norm that has been violated, because the maturity of the loan should not exceed 36 months or 3 years as we have discussed. The next is that the aggregate amount Rupee Circle, a P2P firm, is lending is 10,20,000. So this is the second norm that has been violated, because the cap that has been imposed is of rupees 10 lakhs. Then the next is, while calculating the financial ratios, it found that its leverage ratio is below 2. So this is correct, because it has been mentioned that the leverage ratio should not exceed 2. So this is correct if it is below 2. So the total norms that have been violated by Rupee Circle is 2. So our answer is option C. I hope that with this example, you are able to remember the norms of P2P lending firm. And these are some of the P2P lending firms here. Now let's move on to the next question for today. Now this question says that Mr. A, an American resident, holds the shares of XYZ Limited, an Indian firm. He wants to convert his shares into depository receipts. The depository bank converts those shares into ADRs without cooperation or informing XYZ Limited. So what is a suitable term to describe such depository receipt? Now to answer this question, you first must understand the terms that have been given in the options. So before discussing these terms one by one, first let's understand the mechanism of depository receipts to have an insight into this concept. So this is a circular flow that I have made for you. So this circle starts from overseas investor Mr. A. So Mr. A, an American investor, he wants to invest in an Indian company. Now to issue shares to Mr. A, this Indian company has to maintain or give some shares to a domestic custodian which is situated in India. Now this domestic custodian will update or inform the overseas depository bank which is situated in the country of the investor, that is in America. Overseas depository bank then acknowledges Mr. A with a depository receipt of that Indian company. So when this bank acknowledges Mr. A, this acknowledgement is termed as depository receipt. Now these are just like shares, but they are issued abroad through a depository bank. And these depository receipts can be traded just like shares on the stock exchanges. Now after understanding the basic concept that what DRs are, let's move back to the question. The first is American depository receipts. So when an Indian company raises money from an American investor, that is termed as ADRs. With ADRs, let me discuss two other type of depository receipts also. The first is GDRs. So the difference between ADRs and GDRs are that ADRs relate only to the American investors, whereas GDRs is when an Indian company raises money from investors in America and European countries. The third is Indian depository receipt. So when a foreign company raises money from the Indian investors. So these names, as you can see, are based on the domicile of the investors. Now let's move on to the sponsored depository receipts. So sponsored depository receipts means when the Indian issuer enters into a formal agreement with the foreign depository for creation or issues of DRs. For example, there is an American investor A and he holds the shares of an Indian company. Now this American investor wants to convert these shares into ADRs. Then he gives its shares to a domestic custodian in India. If this custodian maintains a formal agreement with the Indian company and informs it, and then it issues ADRs to Mr. A, then that is termed as sponsored depository receipts. Whereas unsponsored depository receipts means where there is no formal agreement between the foreign depository and the Indian issuer. So any person other than the Indian issuer may, without any involvement of the issuer, deposit the securities with the domestic custodian in India and the foreign depository then issues DRs abroad on the back of such deposited securities. So when there is no formal agreement between the Indian company and the foreign depository, then that is termed as unsponsored depository receipts. So by now you must have guessed the answer of this question. Now let's discuss privately placed depository receipts in brief. Now rule 144A, depository receipts are special ADRs that can only be sold to qualified institutional buyers as a private placement, and they are not subject to the same rules and regulations as ADRs. Now I hope that you have understood these two terms very easily through an example that I have made, that when the foreign depository issues ADRs to A without any formal agreement, that is termed as unsponsored ADRs, and when this foreign depository have a formal agreement with the Indian issuer and then it issues ADRs to Mr. A, then that is sponsored depository receipts. So the answer to our question is unsponsored depository receipts. Now let's move on to the next question for today. The question is that what are the norms set for establishing a new entity for manufacturing to avail a lower tax of 15%? Choose the correct from the following. So before reading on to the options, let's move on to the next slide to understand the norms set for establishing a new entity for manufacturing. Now recently, Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman has come up with many changes in the taxes. So one such change was the low tax regime for new manufacturing. So to boost manufacturing and the Make in India initiative, the government has slashed the corporate tax rate to 15% from the earlier 25% for domestic companies incorporated on or after 1st October 2019. So this point I have also discussed in the previous finance MCQs also. So today we are going to discuss the norms which are set for these manufacturing companies, because after the news, many manufacturing firms have stopped their plan for expansion and they thought that they should build up or establish a new entity so as to avail a lower tax of 15%. In return, the government has given some norms for these companies as well, that these companies should not use the same plant and machinery in the new entity. Further, if the companies try to sell off their existing assets which are in the old company only to be bought by the new entity, then this transaction would come under the general anti-avoidance rule. The next thing is that new entity cannot have more than 20% of their existing employees, and new entity has to look for new customers as well. So in brief, there should be no restructuring of the business if such manufacturing firms are planning to establish a new entity and have stopped their expansion plan. Now, after understanding these norms, let's move back to the question to answer it. So the first point says that new entity cannot have more than 25% of the existing employees. So this is wrong because it is 20%. Then we have company should not use the same plant and machinery in the new entity. This is correct. Third is if a company tries to sell their existing assets only to be brought by the new entity, then such companies will come under the jurisdiction of Ministry of Commerce. So this is wrong because it will come under general anti-avoidance rule. Then we have new entity will have to look out for new customers. So this is also correct. So the correct norms that have been set for these entities are 2 and 4. So our answer is option D. I hope that you have understood these concepts. Now let's move on to the next question for today. Okay, so this question relates to FM and this is a really interesting question, and I hope that you all should answer it in the comment section below. Although I'll be discussing this question in detail, but be honest to yourself and after reading this question, think in your mind that what should be the answer, and if you want to participate, then do comment the answer below. Now, the question says that Project X with a life of 3 years gives NPV of INR 8000, whereas project Y with a life of 5 years gives NPV of 9500 at a discount rate of 15%. So the project manager, he opts for project X. Now the question is that is he correct in his decision or not? So four options have been given to you. First is yes, he's correct by choosing project X over project Y despite project X having lower NPV, as we can see in this question. The second is no, he should have selected project Y as per the NPV technique. Third is can't say because the information is missing related to the size of the project. Fourth is that both the projects provide the same ENPV, so his decision is indifferent. Now we need to understand what ENPV is. So let's move to the next slide to answer this question. Okay, so we need to understand what equivalent annuity method is. So it is used when the life of two projects are different. So as we can see that project X had a life of 3 years, whereas project Y had a life of 5 years. Its NPV was 8000 and its NPV is 9500. The discount rate that has been given to you was 15%. So it's calculated as annuity amount is equals to present value of annuity divided by PVAF factor. Now this present value of annuity you can get from the NPV because it is the present value of the cash flow. So its annuity comes out to be 8000 divided by PVAF for 3 years at 15%, it is 2.283 and it comes out to be 3504. Similarly, its annuity comes out to be, now it is 3.352 because 15% at 5 years, so it comes out to be 2834. So thus, an equivalent annuity is an annual cash inflow arising perpetually at the end of each year in the future. Now you have got these two annuity, so it is obvious that you will be choosing this one because it has a higher equivalent annuity. So let's move back to the question now. So our answer is yes, he is correct by choosing project X over project Y despite project X having a lower NPV, because as per equivalent annuity, project X is having a higher annuity, and when there is a life disparity between the two projects, then we should opt for equivalent annuity method. Now moving on to the last question for today. The question is again related to financial management. So which of the following statements is correct? So you have been given four options and you have to tell me that which one is the correct one. Before answering it, you must know that what PI stands for and what is the relation between PI and NPV. So PI is the profitability index and it is the present value of cash inflows divided by present value of cash outflows. So PI is interpreted as that in present value terms, for every rupee one invested, the proposal is expected to get a return of the amount that we are going to get as profitability index after dividing this. And I know that you remember that what is the formula of NPV? That is present value of cash inflows minus the present value of cash outflows. So I hope that by now you must have understood the relation between these two. So let's see that if PI is less than 1, then the NPV is less than 0. Now, when will this PI be less than 1? When the numerator is smaller than the denominator, which means that present value of cash inflows is less than the present value of cash outflows, and that is where NPV is less than 0. Let's look at the other options also. When PI is 0, its NPV is greater than 0. Now this option is inherently wrong because PI can never be 0, because on dividing cash inflows and cash outflows, you can not get 0 because it has to be some real numbers. Then the third part is when PI is greater than 1, its NPV will be negative. So this is again wrong, because if PI is greater than 1, which means that the numerator is greater than denominator, and which in the NPV terms means that NPV will be positive in this case. And then we have the last option, that PI of a project is always greater than 1, which is again false, because it can be less than 1 as well. So the correct answer is option A, that when PI is less than 1, NPV is less than 0. So with this, we have completed our 5 questions of finance for today, and I hope that you have understood these concepts in a very clear manner, because these concepts are really important as per your examinations. If you haven't subscribed to our channel yet, then do subscribe to our channel for more related videos. Thank you for watching the video.